is Herb Kressel, editor of Radiology, and today I'm joined by Dr. Stephen Baker, professor and chair in the Department of Radiology and associate dean of continuing medical education at New Jersey Medical College. Welcome, Dr. Baker.
Thank you.
Dr. Baker and his colleagues have authored two fascinating articles appearing in the February issue, doing an analysis of malpractice suits across the United States. And Dr. Baker has had access to a very unusual database. Can you tell us a little bit about the database that you got access to for these two studies?
Sure. For the past 15 years, I've been doing credentialing for a company called One Call Medical Incorporated, which is a preferred provider organization for workman's compensation cases. And in my capacity as director of credentialing, I need to look at the files of each radiologist who seeks to become enrolled as a member, as a reader for this program. Every new entry is looked at, and everyone on a three-year cycle. And from that information, not only do I have their name, their gender, their location, but I also have their malpractice history as evidenced by capsule descriptions of each suit in which a claim has been made against them.
I see. And how large is the network that One Call actually has? How many physicians were actually included in your database?
Well, now One Call Medical has 10,000 radiologists over the 32,000 in the United States. When we looked at the series up until 2010, it was 8,400.
Wow, that's impressive. And what sort of drove you to actually try to analyze this? It's enough work just trying to credential these individuals.
Well, I thought, well, this was an interesting database. Most of the articles we've seen on malpractice are remembrances of individuals or small surveys or studies of all physicians, with radiologists being a small part. Here I had access without their commentaries of about 25% of all the radiologists in the country.
Very
I said, this is something we should look at.
Sure. Now, of course, for the study, the individuals were de-identified.
Yes.
It was no surprise to the company that you were doing the analysis. Is that correct?
No surprise to the company. They welcomed the opportunity to be able to share, ultimately, a new knowledge from the
right.
database we had.
Right.
And yes, when we looked at the numbers, they were at the individuals, they were de-identified. Moreover, when we looked at them by state, if there were too few individuals in any one state, less than 50, we eliminated them from much of our data, because you could go back and find out if it was one group supplying all those individuals, that it would be that group. So we limited it to more than 50 respondents or enrollees.
So your group is publishing two manuscripts. One of them is on the demographics of malpractice suits in the United States, and I was struck by the variability that you encountered, both in the number of suits and in the awards, regionally and by state. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
We were surprised, too, to find out the great variability. The variability, besides the number of enrollees, which I mentioned, the variability in the number of those who have been sued, the variability in those in which a judgment or settlement was made, and the variability in the extent of the award. So in each of those areas, we see wide differences.
Now, you also have this rather frightening statistic that over sort of as a radiologist reaches 60, which I've reached past, you have about a 50% chance of having a suit, being named in a suit, over your practice lifetime.
That's right. Over age 60, it's about a 50% chance that you will have ever been sued. Now, that does not mean that there's been a judgment against you, but that a claim was made. It could be abortive, but a claim was made.
Well, for I think most radiologists, just having a claim made is life-altering to a large extent.
That's correct. Yes.
So which states are sort of have the least frequency of assertions and suits?
The least frequent are in the Southeast. North Carolina, Alabama, to Georgia, Mississippi. Even though in Mississippi, for example, it has been known as jackpot justice cases, where the number of suits ultimately are very small, but the awards in all medical specialties can be very large.
That's interesting, because I think there's actually a subspecialty, a legal profession that's sort of based in Mississippi that deals with a lot of focused litigation.
Yes, that's true.
So
Mississippi and Louisiana.
Yes, and now which states have the highest rates and what's the magnitude of the difference?
The magnitude is between about 15% and over 50%.
Wow.
Now, if we take a look at those states, there is no geographic clustering. Yes, New York and New Jersey, over 50% of the people who were enrollees had been sued, whatever their age in the years in practice. And the third state was Utah.
Utah.
Right. And coming up right behind that was Missouri and Kansas.
Huh.
I do not know why.
Okay, well, hopefully in the future we'll get more data and start to find out
right,
why.
Right.
Now, the other thing that you reported on was the age and gender differences. Can you tell us a little bit about those?
Yes, we had about 50% of the enrollees were women, slightly lower than the percentage of 21%. So we're maybe a little bit different in the population, but what we found was that up until age 50, the chance that you have been sued at least once is the same for men and women radiologists. But over 50, there was a considerably greater chance that a male radiologist would have been sued compared with the chances that a female radiologist would have been sued.
That's very interesting. I don't know how to even think about that. Do you have any ideas as to what could be driving those differences?
Just ideas. Please, just ideas.
Yeah.
One thing could be that the older radiologists differentiated themselves in procedures, or they might have differentiated themselves in the case mix, but we haven't investigated this further. And so I'm not going to speculate any more than those two leads.
Thank you. Now, in your second paper, you start reporting on the actual causes and types of suits. Can you tell us about what you found there?
Yes. Among all causes of suits, by far the most common was an allegation of error in diagnosis. Almost multiple times more than the second most common, which was a procedural error. Less common still were communication errors. Bearing in mind, this is the primary allegation. Doesn't mean that there were subsidiary issues in the suits, but they didn't come into our data, which just looked at primary allegation. Below that were contrast reactions, which have not increased, even though the amount of contrast agent that's given has increased. And the most remarkable thing to me was failure to recommend the test was a very rare cause of a malpractice suit being initiated.
And in the problems in diagnosis, breast, I guess, was the most common.
Breast was the most common of a particular site. The musculoskeletal system was more common than breast.
Okay.
And so second was the non-spinal peripheral bones, and third
for fractures,
mostly for fractures.
Okay,
but for any cause, but mostly for fractures, and third was the spine, followed by the GI tract, and then the chest.
Wow. And any change in the trends related to breast as a problem?
Yes, looking at the older literature, in the early 90s, when mammography was not exclusively a radiologist diagnosis or technique, we've seen that the incidence of breast cases as the radiologist being the defendant has increased of all breast cases.
Okay.
In fact, it's nearly 100% now.
Wow. Wow, that's quite striking. Now, I mentioned to you as we were chatting earlier that the Harvard hospitals are all insured by CRICO, which is a sort of combined self-insurance company. And CRICO reports to us quite regularly, and at least for the Harvard Hospital and affiliates' experience, breast has actually been decreasing, and failures of communications have overtaken failures in diagnosis. And it's kind of, I was very surprised when I read your manuscript, and I don't know if it's a matter of the difference in reporting, or perhaps just differences in practice style or in litigation.
Well, the differences that you mentioned to what our data is interesting. Bear in mind that what we're looking at really is the primary allegation as reported either in the National Practitioners Data Bank, if there has been a settlement against the radiologist, and the radiologist comment on the cases when there is no settlement or when they've been exonerated. So that is their remembrance of the most important feature of the case.
Okay.
If the communication issue was a component of that, it's not reported in our data, but it may very well exist.
I see, I see. Now, the other thing I just was kind of curious about, in the if you have a practitioner with multiple suits and assertions, does it affect the way you credential them, or do you take into account the variability and frequency? How is this affecting people's day-to-day lives? We live in a world where you have, I think, a 15-fold difference depending on where you're practicing. How does that play out in terms of credentialing?
Well, I look for an egregious situation in terms of the malpractice suits. If the award is very high, if the issue is one in which I think the radiologist should have made the diagnosis. For example, I'll tell you, if they missed the pneumoperitoneum, I really want to know, why did that happen?
Right.
Okay. But if it's the issue where there are common suits, like there are multiple breast cases in which there's a judgment, then I've got to look at the area, because there are certain places where suits against radiologists for missing a diagnosis in breast radiology, especially when the patient is between 40 and 49 years of age, it's very difficult to say the radiologist should have made the diagnosis. That does not prevent the plaintiff or the plaintiff's family from initiating a suit.
Sure.
So if I see that we have a situation in a particular area, I will put that into perspective for recredentialing.
Good. Well, Dr. Baker, I want to thank you so much for joining us here, and for, I'm sure all of our readers will benefit from the insights of your very, very vast experience in this area.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.